In the world of MMA, a new star has emerged. A relentless Irish warrior who is the embodiment of a martial artist, reigning as the undisputed Invicta Strawweight Champion and carrying the hopes of an entire nation on her shoulders. But now, a new challenger has risen from the heart of Poland. A striking virtuoso with knockout power that can finish a fight in the blink of an eye, determined to stake her claim as queen of the strawweight division. Tonight, the stage is set in the heart of Boston, where powerhouse Karolina, the Polish assassin Wojcik, a relentless force honed by fierce determination, challenges mad Danni McCormack, an undisputed champion who's undefeated in the Invicta cage and backs down from no one. Two fighters competing for the most coveted prize in combat sports. A battle that is fierce, ferocious, flawless. Will it be Irish pride or Polish power? It's Invicta FC 54, McCormack versus Wójcik, for the World Strawweight Championship, and it starts right now.
Boston, Massachusetts, a city home to many iconic sports champions, is the backdrop tonight for a strawweight title tilt as the fighting pride of Ireland takes on a Polish assassin destined to take her crown. Will she do it? We will find out in our main event. It's Invicta FC 54, McCormack versus Wójcik. Hey everybody, I'm TJ DeSantis, along with the staple to this Invicta FC commentary team, it is Julie Kedzie and the former featherweight queen, Megan Anderson. We appreciate you joining us tonight for Invicta FC 54. Julie, it's our first time here in Boston, and tonight we hope to make some history.
That's right, TJ. The Phoenix rises in the shadow of Fenway Park, and please forgive me, we are ready to spill all the tea tonight.
Was that an American history joke?
Of course.
Nice, I like it. You know, Megan, on fight night, we always turn our focus to the main event, but we have an undercard of stars in the making, and we'll see who breaks out tonight.
We do, TJ. We've got a lot of new talent tonight here at Invicta FC 54. Bright lights, big opportunities. We're about to find out who's going to rise to the occasion.
Of course, in our main event, the strawweight title will be on the line. This is a division that has always been small in stature, but big in talent. And for Danni McCormack, Julie, she hopes to pen the first chapter of her championship legacy.
That's right, TJ, but don't make the mistake of telling her that this is a title defense. To Danni McCormack, this is just another opportunity to show the world that she is a fantastic fighter, that she is a world champion, and that she will dominate. Danni McCormack burst onto the scene of Invicta, you know, really surprising us. Undefeated record. She actually was dropped twice in her title fight against Valeska Machado in the first round. Came from behind in this technical, gritty, beautiful, inspiring performance to win the belt. And she says, yeah, I'm not defending the belt tonight. I'm going to show you that I'm great. I'm going to show you Irish pride, and I'm going to walk home a champion.
She will hope to prove that she is the queen by taking out a familiar foe. And Karolina Wójcik, the Polish assassin, is a face that is familiar to Danni McCormack.
She is, and for Wójcik, this opportunity is a culmination of a lifetime dedicated to mixed martial arts. And like you said, TJ, this rematch is 6 years in the making, having previously beaten McCormack as an amateur back in 2017. You know, this is an opportunity on the highest level of the sport. There's a lot more stakes in this rematch, and championship gold is right within Wojciech's grasp, and she knows that she is walking into the lion's den tonight, and this is the fight of her life, she told us. And when she goes in there, she is ready to take all of the spoils in her pursuit to become the new Invicta strawweight champion, TJ.
It is a title that has only been successfully defended one time prior, and whoever walks out tonight will be one of the best strawweights in mixed martial arts. Let's take a look at some of the other action that is headed your way live from Boston tonight. We'll see the warhorse Kristina Williams take on Dee Begley in a flyweight fight. Hilarie Rose is in action tonight when she takes on Andrea, Amaro, the German, now training at American Top Team in Southern Florida. Julia Dorny makes her Invicta FC debut when she takes on Rad Riley Martinez. And we will kick things off with a bantamweight bout as the Canadian Maria Djukic faces the Brazilian in Fernanda Araujo. Live from Boston, this is Invicta FC 54.
When we return, Brazil's Fernanda Araujo makes her Invicta FC debut when she takes on the heavy-handed Canadian in Sweet Maria Djukic. You're watching Invicta FC 54.
Earning
earning the nickname Ferocious, Brazil's Fernanda Araujo is known for pushing a furious pace. A black belt in both judo and karate, Araujo has added boxing to her fighting arsenal. Tonight, she'll call on all skills necessary to prove that she's here to make an impact at Invicta FC.
Expect a good fight. I can't wait to step in the cage. I want to show a little bit of everything, for sure. I want to strike and take to the ground and finish.
Fighting out of Canada, Maria Djukic takes the Invicta FC cage for the second time in her career. Despite owning the nickname Sweet, Djukic isn't afraid to get nasty inside the cage, with her last fight turning into an all-out brawl. A fan favorite for her all-action offensive style, Djukic comes into tonight's fight with a point to prove.
Obviously, she's really tough standing up, just like how any fight goes. But the way I've prepared for this fight is, you know, making sure she doesn't work on her strengths, which is, you know, using her judo, using her jiu-jitsu, and essentially just breaking her rhythm and doing my thing.
Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for this bantamweight bout. 32 years old is the Brazilian Fernanda Araujo, 3 years the elder of the Canadian Sweet Maria Djukic. Djukic stands 3 inches taller, and we are on points at 135 even for the Canadian, 134.9 for the Brazilian. It is the Canadian that will have a reach advantage. For our introductions of this first fight of the night, we go to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening and welcome to the House of Blues here in Beantown, Boston, Massachusetts. And we're excited to bring you Invicta FC, a night of women's mixed martial arts for your entertainment. And our fight fans, here we go. 3 rounds this scheduled in the bantamweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, her background Brazilian jiu-jitsu and judo. At 5'4" tall, she weighed in officially 135 pounds. She enters the cage tonight for the sixth time as a professional, fighting out of Wakefield, Mass. Here is Ferocious Fernanda Araujo! And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. At 5'7" tall, this mixed martial artist also weighed in 135 pounds. In 3 fights, her record stands at 2 victories with 1 defeat, fighting out of Kelowna, British Columbia, Canada. Here is Sweet Maria Djukic! And your referee in charge of the action is John English.
Bantamweight's ready to go here inside the Invicta FC cage. Referee John English getting this assignment. It is Brazil's Fernanda Araujo taking on Sweet Maria Djukic. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson live tonight in Boston. Appreciate you joining us for Invicta FC 54. Djukic in the white, Araujo in the blue shorts. This our 100th bantamweight bout in Invicta FC history.
Nice little feeling out here, period. Feeling out period here, TJ. Nice shots right there.
Beautiful in and out movement of Djukic. Already we're seeing an evolution in her game, particularly in her striking. That range control is beautiful, TJ.
And when we caught up with Araujo, she said she didn't mind being the shorter fighter, but a lot of that comes down to the taller fighter knowing how to utilize that reach.
Oh, 100%. And that's not necessarily always the case.
Djukic using that kick to the lead leg of Araujo.
Nice body shot there by the Brazilian.
And one thing about Djukic is she wanted to display her improved footwork and the things that she's been working on. And she wants to land them as effectively as possible. And we're seeing just that right now. It's like she's a sniper in that, Julie.
Yeah. Yeah, she's doing a great job with that jab and that kick, really bringing out that big shot from Fernanda. And pulling out right away before she gets hit hard.
Araujo training and living locally now, originally from Brazil, said she actually teaches at 5 different schools, so that's why you heard that audible crowd pop here tonight. There's that kick again to the lead leg of Araujo that makes a popping sound as well.
That's right, that inside leg kick, but also both of them have been throwing that inside to the shin kick, kind of the I don't know. What do you call that? A vertical stomp? I'm sure there's a fancy name for it that people hate. Oof, another body shot there. Fernanda Araujo has had a lifetime of combat sports and recently has taken up, you know, serious boxing as well.
Said she started training karate at the age of 3, became an international champion in the single digits of age, and pretty skilled on the floor as well, brown belt in Brazilian jiu-jitsu.
She's just struggling to really close that range right now. That reach is giving her issues. I'd like to see her double, triple up on that lead hand and keep that in close range. You know, she had a beautiful right hand to the body just a couple of moments ago. I'd like to see her go back to the body and maybe fit in so she could start working a little bit of her judo.
That's right, black belt in judo. She says judo is like one of her biggest loves, but you can see she loves all combat sports. You know, she did say she would be a rodeo fighter, or excuse me, a rodeo rider if she wasn't fighting, but she couldn't see herself ever not doing combat sports.
Yeah, she said she visits back home down in Brazil, and she's either on the farm or in the gym. Inside the final 2 minutes here of round number one.
One thing Wójcik told us is she has never felt more prepared for a fight in her life than today.
She credited that to making those moves and those adjustments. And Megan, that's something that's really important for a fighter. The longer you're in this game, you need to get different looks, and sometimes you need to seek out different training partners.
Yeah, and when you're in an environment that, you know, you kind of grew up in, she started at a very, you know, small gym, and she kind of got to a point, she said after her last fight, that she needed to go and get some different looks. She needed to train with different bodies, and we're seeing, you know, that pay off right now. She is looking phenomenal so far in this fight.
Again, utilizing those kicks. We haven't seen Araujo try to use those kicking attacks from Wójcik as handles. She hasn't really gone for a takedown. She's content to stand on the outside. Do you think that's wise, Julie?
No, no, I don't. But, you know, it's interesting. She has a strategy still. She has a plan for this fight. But, you know, she wants to get in there. She wants to get in close and get that judo. Nice right hand there from the Brazilian.
See if she can land more of those strikes.
And it almost looks like Araujo is starting to find the timing on Wójcik. When Wójcik is coming in, sometimes when she throws her right hand, she almost pauses at the end before getting out of range. And if Araujo can time her own right hand at that moment, I mean, she could have a lot of success with that.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's exactly a Philly shell from Sweet Maria, but that double jab cross is going to land.
Round one in the books, round two coming up. This is Invicta FC live from Boston. Let's take a look at some of the action here from round number one. Julie, walk us through.
Well, you can see that jab we were speaking about from Maria Wójcik. She's landing it very, very well, and also utilizing her front leg kick, drawing out the Brazilian and, you know, not allowing her to counter very well. However, Araujo had some great shots in there with the body shot, some return leg kicks, and in the final minute of the fight, landed some pretty hard right hands. I like the way they're attacking that shin, TJ. You know, hit the front of the leg, hit the side of the leg, hit the inside of the leg. Very, very technical and cool.
See Araujo's offense on display there. We'll see what you can do in round number two. Round two between these bantamweights set to get underway. Again, TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson. Appreciate you joining us live here for Invicta FC 54. Megan, it was a first round where we saw Wójcik utilize her reach. We saw Araujo down the stretch land a couple of shots. Was it enough to steal the round for the Brazilian?
I don't think so, TJ. I think Wójcik definitely took that round. I think she was on the offense a little bit more. She was landing a little more. I know, don't get me wrong, Araujo definitely started pulling back towards the end, I think a little bit too late, but she started to find her timing. She started to find her range. I really want to see her be a little bit more aggressive in this round two, because she needs to get going. She needs to not let Maria set the pace, and I'm loving everything that I'm seeing right now. She's going first, she's setting the pace, and she's setting the combos.
Big punches again by the Brazilian. Julie, we were commenting a little bit in between rounds. This is a smaller cage, a smaller fighting environment, and sometimes that turns up the action.
It really does, TJ. You know, I don't know that if I prefer a small cage or a large cage. I just prefer a cage in general. But I will say one thing that Wójcik is doing very well to keep the smaller fighter from getting inside, the judo black belt from getting inside, is hitting that front leg over and over, making her afraid to plant. Now, maybe afraid is the wrong word, because Araujo is definitely somebody who charges forward and hits hard, but it's a very smart strategy.
Getting confident with those kicks is sweet Maria Djukic. She went high, but the Brazilian landing a nice left hand there.
Oh, nice.
Big right hand.
Hey, work off the hips, right? Let's get off that center line. Work off the hips.
A lot of composure on display here from Fernanda Araujo. Talk about her essentially entire life inside combat sports. She's not going to be rattled easily.
But she is still falling for a lot of those fakes and feints. Wow, sweet Maria is really dialed in right now.
And Araujo, you know, she's closing the range aggressively. She's got a lot of quickness in her feet when she closes the range, but she's allowing Djukic to reopen that range, and it's really hindering her ability to get her own game going. You know, Maria's that jab and that kick is just money every single time, and it's hindering, you know, as the fight goes on with those leg kicks, it's going to hinder the movement of Araujo. She needs to have some urgency to get in range and keep it there.
You can see some blood coming out of the nose of the Brazilian. There's a little blood on sweet Maria's leg too, but it might be from the nose. Oh, nice.
I think it is. It's the product of her offense on display here. Araujo needs to sort of turn this fight, you know, the momentum on its head here. At what point, Megan, does she go for a takedown and try to make this a grappling affair?
At any point. I mean, that's the thing is this is mixed martial arts. Right now, we're seeing a kickboxing fight.
Right.
And Araujo doesn't have the reach to compete in a kickboxing fight. She needs to utilize all of her skills. She's a black belt in judo. She's a brown belt in Brazilian jiu-jitsu. Let's see her try to use that.
Yeah, sometimes we see grapplers try to flex that striking muscle when they have a game opponent in front of them, but you got to call upon all skills necessary in order to get your hand raised.
And I mean, looking at Araujo, she looks like she's having a little bit of issues putting weight and putting weight on that lead leg. Those kicks are starting to add up. She's a little bit, you know, having issues pushing off and putting all of her weight on that lead leg.
And that's going to take away some of her power as well if she continues to strike. So we'll see if she tries to reach for one of those kicking attacks of Djukic to get this fight to the floor, or at least close the distance, get a clinch.
Dude, those inside leg kicks are brutal. There we go.
Nicely done by Djukic to keep this fight at range.
The bruising on Araujo's leg is just red raw. It's already turning black.
We'll see if she tries to switch stances, maybe throw from the southpaw position.
One of the things Wójcik told us is that she, you know, she noticed, or her coaches noticed too, that Araujo tends to slow down in later rounds. Woo, big right hand. She hit a big right hand and Wójcik was right on top of it.
Dying moments here of round number two.
Beautiful jab.
Minutes in the books. Been a nice showcase thus far for sweet Maria Djukic, really landing all of her strikes, and as you pointed out, Megan, really battering and literally bruising that lead leg of Fernanda Araujo.
Look, Djukic looks methodical in there. She looks focused. She looks like she has put in the work and she is absolutely ready, and she is playing to her strengths. She is a striker who has a significant height and reach advantage, and she is utilizing that reach effectively to absolutely shut out Araujo. Now, don't get me wrong, Araujo is having some success with a couple of those right hands, but the range control of Djukic is just too much. Like the jab, the leg kicks, she's absolutely beating up that lead leg of Araujo, and her movement is starting to become compromised.
We're seeing some offense thrown back by Araujo, but Julie, they're really just one strike at a time. It's not the volume that we're seeing from the Canadian.
Yeah, that's true. If there's one strike at a time, TJ, but we're not just seeing that jab. As we watched that footage before, she's also throwing a kind of check hook, coming over the side and really blasting the Brazilian on the right side. The right side is, when she does that, she's stepping to her left. The right side is where the power side is for Araujo. So when Wójcik does that, she's cutting off that power. It's a very beautiful angle and really smart fighting.
Third and final round underway. Sweet Maria Wójcik in the white skirt. The Brazilian Fernanda Araujo in the blue shorts. Another kick again to the lead leg of Araujo. The Brazilian tries to answer with some punches.
It really slows down your ability to blitz, though. Whoa, nice kick there.
And Djukic is doing a really good job. As soon as she's throwing her combinations, as soon as she's throwing her strike, she's either out of range or she's moving. She's cutting an angle. She's never a stationary target, whereas Araujo is right there in front of Djukic, allowing her to just set her pace.
This performance by Wójcik is, you know, really spot on, and really what she said she was going to do. It's one thing to talk the talk, it's another thing to walk the walk, and I mean, she's been doing exactly what she said she was going to do coming into this fight.
And she's putting it all together now. She's mixing up the levels and those kicks. Mm-hmm. She's in a flow state right now, Julie.
Yeah, I mean, she's reading what's happening. You saw that beautiful left kick that came after the jab that landed on the Brazilian. You know, the Brazilian landed the jab, the Canadian lands the kick. And this is just super fun to watch and super technical to watch. And I think something young fighters should be watching right now to watch, you know, to see how this works with height, with distance.
Just an extreme amount of confidence on display here by Wójcik. Again, Araujo, she's dangerous. She's got power, but it is all Wójcik that is controlling the tempo and pace of this fight.
And Araujo, she's only throwing one, maybe two strikes at a time. She needs to start throwing more volume.
But if you look at that front leg, meaning it's so beat up, she can't plant on it.
Exactly, yeah. Julie. And that, and when you go to that inside leg kick and when you go to the outside leg kick, like look at the lump on the shin of Araujo, that leg is severely compromised, and Wójcik has done such a phenomenal job of utilizing that early so it pays dividends as the fight goes on.
Just past the halfway point of this third and final round, you talk about the aesthetics of that leg on the Brazilian. It's rare to see it swell up that quickly mid-fight, and actually the bruise is darkening.
One thing Sweet Maria told us is she really interrogated that loss to Amber Librock. She wanted to know what exactly was going on in her life. There were health problems. You know, the weight cut was hard, but honestly, that interrogation really worked for her.
Yeah, she came up short to Autumn Norton back at Invicta 48, TKO round two. Still time for her to secure a victory tonight and leave it out of the hands of the judges, but I mean, it's pretty much one-way traffic here. If this goes another 100 seconds or so, I think the judges probably gonna side with the Canadian.
And my apologies to Amber and Autumn for mixing up their names in that just now. I know you guys, sorry.
You get excited during fights.
It's really okay. Like this.
You know, Araujo is looking, you know, like she's trying to push the action. I think she knows that she's down on the scorecards and she's trying to really push the pace in this third round. But is it a little bit too late, Julie?
I believe so, but I really like this. Obviously, she is not slowing down in later rounds as, you know, was scouted before, and, you know, that makes her dangerous. Nice hook.
It only takes one strike to really turn the momentum upside down. We'll see if Fernanda Araujo can find that one strike here as we head down the stretch of the final minute of this fight. Crowd coming alive here as these women are giving it their all.
And you can see a little desperation there from Araujo. Hands are down, kind of swinging those hooks. Wójcik stays pretty calm. She's been tagged a couple times now in these exchanges, but she's staying calm. Her feet still move.
Final 10 seconds in the fight.
Oof.
We go 15 full in this bantamweight bout. The judges will tally their 10s and 9s, and we will get our official decision next. Live from Boston, this is Invicta FC. We are back here in Boston inside the House of Blues. We've just gone 15 full minutes here in the bantamweight division. Sweet Maria Djukic put on a show against the Brazilian turned local in Fernanda Araujo. Judges still tallying their 10s and 9s. A solid performance by both ladies. And now for our official decision, we go to Joe Martinez.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the scorecards. The totals are 30-27, 29-28, and 29-28, all for your winner by unanimous decision, Sweet Maria Djukic!
No surprise there. Sweet Maria Djukic getting it done in our opening bout. She will speak to our Megan Anderson after the embrace and sign of sportsmanship. What a night for the Canadian here in Boston as she picks up the first win of her Invicta FC run.
I'm here with your winner, Maria. Wow, absolutely methodical in here tonight. First win here at Invicta Cage. How does this one feel?
I feel like an egg. You know, you put me in boiling hot water and I get harder. I'm not like a potato. I don't get soft.
Interesting analogy. The game plan. Was it leg kicks, the jab, keep the range? Was that how you seen this fight going?
That's a very good observation, absolutely. Just breaking the rhythm, not getting too anxious. You know, obviously she's very well-rounded on the ground, and that was something that I had to be wary of. So keeping the distance and just doing what I wanted to do was the game plan.
Well, you're now 1-1 in Invicta, win under your belt. Who do you want next?
Honestly, this journey, it's more of a spiritual one. So whatever comes my path, essentially, and I'm gonna just be blessed with any opportunity that I'm given. So yeah, thank you, Invicta. This was a great night.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Sweet Maria Djukic.
Rad Riley Martinez making the walk for the first time to the Invicta FC cage. Megan, do you remember your first walk to the Invicta cage?
I do. And I like to joke about this because Julie was my matchmaker back then. But it was it's such an intimidating Well, it can be such an intimidating moment. You know, when you're coming up from, particularly for me, regional Australia, you head out to another country, but in a bigger promotion, the big lights, the media day, the interviews, the photo shoot, and it's just, it can be a lot, but Riley has took everything in absolute stride. She has been a true professional this week for someone who's only 2-0.
2-0, but both with finishes, Megan. You know, this might be her Invicta debut, but this woman loves to fight. She loves to finish.
And that's the thing that I love so much about Invicta is obviously we have established fighters at the top of the card in the main event, but you get athletes that are making their pro debut sometimes or fighting, you know, for the first time within 3 or 4 bouts of their career. They get that first taste of the big show. And for Rat Riley Martinez, she wants to make that first taste a successful and victorious one. In its 11-plus year history, Invicta FC has sought talent from all over the world, and another international import is that of Julia Dorny. Fighting now out of Southern Florida at American Top Team, she is originally from Berlin, Germany, a woman who has been involved in combat sports throughout her entire career. And she comes from the world of judo. When I think about athletes that find mixed martial arts through judo, it's hard not to think and draw comparisons to that of Ronda Rousey.
Exactly, TJ, and Julia has been so inspired by Ronda and her transition to MMA in her own right. You know, when we spoke with her, she said, I've had over 100 judo fights. She's been training since she was 7. And what she's learned is that people have scars. You know, she's been on the national team in judo, multiple time grappling champion, and she never actually assumed, like she never thought she'd ever fall in love with MMA, but watching somebody like Ronda, who has made that transition and so seamlessly, it inspired her. And you know, she is out there at ATT with the likes of, you know, Kayla Harrison, who was also a judoka in her own right, very successful in both judo and mixed martial arts. So she has such an incredible role models around her to help her on this transition to MMA.
You mentioned, you know, some big names. Kayla Harrison, a former Invicta FC champion that she trains with regularly, is a woman formerly known as Yana Kunitskaya, now Yana Santos. She hopes to take everything that she's learned at American Top Team and put it all to the test inside the Invicta FC cage. It's a fun featherweight fight, and it's next here at Invicta FC 54.
Fighting out of SPG, Idaho, Riley Martinez makes her Invicta FC debut after an impressive start to her professional career. At 2-0, Martinez has wasted little time inside the cage, dispatching both of her opponents inside of the first round. Tonight, she plans to pick up the third victory of her career when she meets Julia Dorny.
I know Julia will be coming at me with overhands and some judo throws, just being confident and defending those and just giving her a tough fight overall, but I think it's going to be a good one. I think it's going to go to the end.
Germany's Julia Dorny has had a long, successful amateur career in combat sports, owning multiple championships in judo, sumo wrestling, and mixed martial arts. In her first two professional MMA fights, Dorny finished both of her opponents in impressive fashion. Tonight, she looks for more of the same as she hopes to make a statement in her promotional debut.
Fight fans, be ready for me. I moved here from Germany to pursue my fighting career, and the German tank, look out for me. You will see me very soon on the very top.
Take a look at the tail of the tape for this featherweight bout. The German Julia Dorny, 2 years the elder of the American Rad Riley Martinez. Both women stand 5'9" tall, and we are official in the featherweight class. Both women weighing in at 145. For our official introductions of this bout, we go to Joe Martinez.
And now, fight fans, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. 3 rounds this scheduled in the featherweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, a Brazilian jiu-jitsu practitioner standing 5'9" tall. Weighing in officially 145.25 pounds. In 2 fights, she is perfect with 2 victories and no defeats. Here's the undefeated featherweight from Boise, Idaho, Rad Riley Martinez. And across the cage, her opponent, fighting out of the red corner. Her background is in judo. At 5 feet, 9 inches tall, she weighed in 145 3/4 pounds. In three fights, her record stands at 2 victories with 1 defeat. From Berlin, Germany, here is Julia Dorny! And your referee in charge of the action once again is John English.
Referee John English getting this featherweight assignment. We see the American fighting out of Idaho, Rad Riley Martinez, welcoming the German tank, Julia Dorny, to the Invicta FC cage. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson, live tonight here in Boston. Appreciate you joining us for Invicta FC 54.
Always love it when the featherweights are on the card. Might be a little biased, TJ.
I mean, a former featherweight champion, obviously going to keep an eye on your division. And Julia Dorny talked about the future of the featherweights. You know, this is a weight class that always needs more talent, and she wants to be a role model and welcome that talent. But right now, Riley Martinez closing the distance and looking to take this one to the floor.
Absolutely no feeling out period for Riley Martinez right now. And she's looking to control Dorny on the cage.
Huge statement here early for Martinez in this fight to the floor.
Looking to get those hooks in. She's got both hooks in now.
Landing her out now.
Confidence definitely growing here as Martinez gets this fight to the floor. We're just a minute in.
Nice shots there. You can see she's snaking her right hand in, trying to get underneath the chin. She rolls through. She's under the arm there. Chest to back. Chest to back, Riley. Dorny is addressing the hands as you need to do, a hands and hips when somebody has your back. Now Martinez's ankles are crossed, so you can see Dorny trying to go and attack the feet there. Martinez still looking for that rear naked choke, landing some heavy fire. She came in blasting right hands, and she's continuing to do so from the ground.
And credit to Martinez, you know, rolling with this, securing the position, now trying to lock up this choke.
And you know, under the chin or across the face, that hurts. I mean, it chokes you under the chin.
Oh, that's tight. Incredible.
That is super
tight. That's tight.
Dorny hanging tough, but she scores a tap. It is done. Rad Riley Martinez, undefeated, moves her record now to 3-0. Picks up the first win of her Invicta FC run with a huge statement.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes officially 1 minute 48 seconds. Round number one, submission by rear naked choke for your winner. And still undefeated, Rad Riley Martinez.
Rad Riley Martinez getting it done. Submission victory in her Invicta FC debut. She will speak with Megan.
What a statement. First fight in Invicta, you put on an absolute performance, first round stoppage. This has got to feel good, this one.
Yes, it feels super good, super pumped. I let it out at the end, you know, you got to get it out because I was ready to go all three. So one and done, now it's time for a drink, and that's about it, yeah.
Well, you came out pretty strong in the first round. You put it on her right away. Do you see, was that the game plan? Did you want to really just push the pace for three rounds and see what happens?
I'll always go the three rounds if I have to, but I don't ever leave it to a judge's decision whatsoever. I knew Julia was going to come at me hard, and she did. She popped me in the face, and we just got to keep the chin down, and we did what we needed to do. I'm happy I got the submission. I usually get TKO, so I'll take the submission.
Well, the featherweight division is pretty open right now. You now want to know in the Invicta cage, what fight do you want to see next for you?
Whoever wants this, come at me, let's go. We just got to keep moving up from here. And whoever wants to fight me, I'm here.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Rad Riley Martinez.
Riley Martinez looking pretty rad inside the Invicta FC cage tonight in her debut. Wraps up a rear naked choke stoppage. And Megan said it, she made quite a statement at 145.
Total statement. It seems like all night I've been scared I'm going to say SBG Idaho or SBG Ireland. Totally conflate them. You know, SBG Ireland, we've got two fighters on the card. It's such a vaulted gym, but looks like SBG Idaho is producing some pretty phenomenal fighters too, TJ.
Yes, Riley Martinez getting it done tonight in a very big way. Live from Boston, this is Invicta FC 54.
When we come back, Andrea Amaro makes her return to the cage after more than a year away from active competition. Tonight, she takes on the New England native and 9-year MMA veteran, Hilarie Rose. You're watching Invicta FC 54.
Fighting out of El Paso, Texas, Andrea Amaro is making the walk to the Invicta FC cage for the first time, 3-2 as a pro. Before she got into MMA, she was a two-time national JUCO champion in the half marathon. Interesting to see an athlete make the change from running to fighting, but she said, Megan, that change actually running helped her prepare for MMA, said running is really a mental game, and obviously you know better than anybody, fighting's a pretty big mental game as well.
It really is, and when she was talking to us and telling us that she is a runner and she likes to do marathons, all that, I was like, I mean, listen, girl, there's gonna be something loose if I am not a runner. I was like, hats off to you. But that cardio that she brings, and when you watch her fight, she's fast, she's strong, she is blending everything together, and her pace is absolutely relentless. So now that she's switched over and is really predominantly fighting in MMA, she's really able to utilize all of her skill sets because she's so well conditioned.
Yeah, we'll see what she can do tonight as she makes her Invicta FC debut. It's her first fight in over a year. She wants to make it a successful one. But standing in her way is the American fighting out of Massachusetts. It is Hilarie Rose, and Julie, you can hear the crowd here inside the House of Blues. They've come out to support their local fighter.
That's right. It's like she's the Rose of Massachusetts. Hilarie Rose telling us, coming into this fight, you know, I hate my record. It's not indicative of how good I am. And I can relate to that. I think there's a lot of fighters out there who can relate to that. This is a woman who loves to fight, loves to push herself, and really breaks things down. Her fighting style, her opponent's fighting style, very cerebral human being.
She finds herself as a slight favorite tonight and a huge fan favorite. Written, I am first, none after me. Gotta take pieces, sap out to let it out. BB's a warning shot. I am aiming at your feet. Just wanna warn them, I ain't. Strawweight's on deck here inside the House of Blues in Boston for Invicta FC 54. We see Hilarie Rose making her first few steps here inside the Invicta FC cage in front of a fan-friendly crowd. She hopes to put on a show.
Fighting out of El Paso, Texas, Andrea Amaro comes to Boston riding a 2-fight win streak. Returning to the cage for the first time in more than a year, the Texas native is eager to get back into action as she hopes to pick up her third straight victory inside her Invicta FC debut.
I want to show a little bit of everything, a little bit of my MMA, of what I do, striking, cage work, takedowns, jiu-jitsu. It's not just about me, but about the people who I have around me. They put time, effort, sacrifice. So it's just not just for me, it's for everybody. Just a little bit of notoriety, especially from the city I come from.
Looking to break her momentum is US MMA product Hilarie Rose. A New England native, Rose has been fighting for nearly a decade, which includes an appearance on Dana White's Contender Series. Tonight, she'll call upon her experience as she looks to shine under the bright lights in her Invicta FC debut.
Coming off two losses, I definitely want to come into this fight feeling good defensively, off my feet. And even if I do get taken down, getting back up or scrambling from the bottom, being able to dictate submissions if I see them. So I'm looking forward to getting back in the cage as a veteran and especially for it.
Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for this strawweight scrap. The Massachusetts native, Hilarie Rose, 2 years the elder than the El Paso native, Andrea Amaro. It is Rose that will have a 2-inch height advantage. It equates to a 1-inch reach advantage. For our official introductions of this bout, we go to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. Three rounds this scheduled in the strawweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. Her background is in Brazilian jiu-jitsu. At 5 feet, 1 inch tall, she weighed in officially 115 pounds. In five fights, her record stands at 3 victories with 2 defeats. Fighting out of El Paso, Texas, here is Andrea Amaro. And across the cage stands her opponent, fighting out of the red corner. Her background, jiu-jitsu. At 5 feet, 3 inches tall, she weighed in at the strawweight limit, 116 pounds. In 12 fights, her record stands even with 6 victories and 6 defeats. Fighting out of and representing Norfolk, Massachusetts, here is Hilarie. And your referee in charge of the action is Kevin McDonald.
Kevin McDonald getting this strawweight assignment. A pair of newcomers to the Invicta FC cage as we see Texas's Andrea Amaro taking on the Massachusetts native Hilarie Rose. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson live tonight inside the House of Blues in Boston, Massachusetts. Appreciate you joining us for Invicta FC 54.
See, Rose immediately takes the center of the cage. Pretty good veteran move there.
Yeah, that might be a big battle tonight with such a small fighting enclosure. You want to take that center, you got to do it quick.
That real estate in the middle pays off 100%. And you know, Rose is doing a really good job. She's looking very composed. Big right hand there.
We talk about Rose's record, 6-6. She said that that is not really reflective of how talented she is, and she really wants to make a statement tonight in this fight. She says she's a fighter that rises to the occasion. Well, the lights are pretty bright here at Invicta.
Yeah, and she, when we spoke to her, she said she was feeling so excited for this opportunity. She feels like every opportunity that she's had to fight for Invicta, something's come up, and it's never really been able to eventuate in an actual fight. So she is happy to be here and really showcase who she really is. She wants to show everybody that,
oh, big shot.
Andrea Amaro coming alive with some strikes here. Rose still with it, gets back to her feet, but you can see Amaro starting to take over now inside the clinch.
And that was extremely smart, TJ. Amaro hit that big right hand. She came back with another flurry, faked a flurry, and then came in for the clinch. You know, something Rose had said about Amaro is like she doesn't see her faking and fainting a lot, but you can fake and faint with shots too, and then set something else up. Very smart.
Beautiful head control here by Amaro. I know you love that, Julie.
I love head control, that's right. Not so much foot stomps if I'm the recipient, but yeah.
Same.
I always think it's the next day that just hurts so much when you're on the plane.
Double underhooks here for the Texas native in Andrea Amaro. Amaro, a Brazilian jiu-jitsu brown belt. She said that she expected Rose to try to exchange here on the feet. She's found success of her own, but now trying to get back to what she calls sort of her bread and butter. She said she's a lover of Brazilian jiu-jitsu, but you can't show that off unless you get the fight to the floor. But Rose, having none of it, makes some space and finds her way back to the center of the cage.
A great composure there by Hilarie Rose, just staying calm, not giving Amaro any space to really work that takedown, and circling up the cage, big right hand of her own right there. And you know, Rose is letting Amaro set the pace a little bit. She's letting Amaro go first. Now, I'd like to see her, you know, initiate some of these exchanges a little bit more.
Now back inside the clinch.
Oh, nice little trip there.
Beautiful.
Good amount of time here for Amaro to work inside this half guard.
Now, Amaro looking to get that leg untrapped so she can work into full mount.
And her base right there looks extremely strong. She's able to transition to the side.
Knee on belly here for Amaro.
fancy rows trying to spin off. You don't want to be parallel to the cage right there. You want to be able to use the cage to get back up.
Both women are brown belts in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
Amaro doing a really good job of getting Rose's, you know, body off the cage so she's not able to utilize it. But, you know, Rose going for an armbar.
Big shots there from Amaro. Looks like her elbow is, oh, yep, elbow totally free now. On the
now
back.
On the back.
Wow.
Wow, she's fast.
She got that right hook in trying to get this rear naked choke. It is locked in.
Oh,
it is done. Wow. Andrea Amaro via rear naked choke in round number one. What a night for her as she secures the victory and submission in her Invicta FC debut.
Ladies and gentlemen, the rear naked choke submission comes officially. 4 minutes, 19 seconds. Round number one, your winner from El Paso, Texas, Andrea Amaro.
Andrea Amaro getting the fourth win of her MMA career tonight here in Boston. She will speak.
I'm here with our winner. Wow. That back take was absolutely phenomenal. But, I mean, you've had a long layoff. It has been over a year since you last fought. How emotional is this moment for you coming back, putting on the performance that you did?
It's super emotional. You know, I struggle with an autoimmune disease. I have lupus. I broke my hand twice. I pulled my groin. You know, my coaches and my family, they go through everything with me to put me through these fight camps and keep me training all year. And it feels awesome to be back in here.
Well, this performance tonight, you know, you were able to sting her and kind of rock her a little bit with that right hand. Did you feel that the striking was going to be there for you, or did you know that you kind of want to take this one to the ground?
Well, I know that I can bang, but I wanted to show just everything, that I'm an all-around fighter, and that's what I really showed today.
Well, the 115-pound division is very active right now. We've got a championship fight later on tonight. First fight in Invicta, it was a success. You really put on, you know, everybody else on the roster on notice. What fight would you like to see next?
Anybody they want to give me. If you tell me to fight, I fight.
Do you have a particular time frame in time that you would like to get back?
No, I'm always training. That's what it's for.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for your winner, Amaro.
Karolina Wójcik is going to be a rematch. A few years in the making, Megan. These ladies met previously as an amateur, and obviously in the pro ranks, the stakes are amped up tonight.
They did. 6 years in the making. They both fought each other back in 2017. And when we spoke to Danni earlier this week, she said Karolina was notorious on the show that they fought on back then. And she was actually warned by some of the cut men before the fight that Karolina was going to run across the cage at her. And, you know, she was coming off a couple back-to-back early stoppages. But Danni said, you know, I was able to walk her down. And back then, she'd only had a couple of amateur fights. And now Danni is the one that has the belt. Danni is the one that is trying to solidify her territory as the champion. And Karolina is the one that's going to have to bring the fight to the champion, Julie.
And Karolina, you know, we've seen in her footage, she's a very patient, patient fighter. So it's going to be an interesting battle of not just their fists and, you know, in the cage, but it's actually of will to see who can draw things out. You know, we've seen Karolina as more of a counter fighter in the past. Very patient, looks for those shots, but extraordinarily fast. She's like a little buzzing bee in there, pop, pop, pop. And Danni McCormack, I mean, like I said, when she won the title, her gym is called Relentless. She is relentless. Danni McCormack will not quit unless somebody stops her. And that's what Karolina is looking to do tonight, get a stop.
And we are official for the title tonight as both women came in at championship weight. It is the Polish assassin taking on Danni McCormack, the reigning defending champion. We will see what happens. We are scheduled 5 5-minute rounds for the undisputed Invicta FC Strawweight Championship of the World. Making the walk tonight for the first time in her Invicta run, it is her debut, is the 4-2 fighter fighting out of Dublin, Ireland, Dee Begley. Upgraded her status to the co-main event tonight. And that's interesting, Julie, when you think about her teammate being in the main event. Now all of a sudden logistics come into play and you need to start talking about who you're warming up with, and you know that whole process kind of gets turned upside down, and these are the adjustments you need to make on fight night.
That's true. I'm really glad we don't have swing bouts here, because man, being the swing bout is a real pain. But you know, Dee Begley, what an extraordinary person. She's really fun to talk to, TJ. And having her teammate on the card, she said it's been great. It's been great. You know, she's traveled all over before for other promotions, but just, you know, being there and having her teammate there with her who's also fighting, it's been very helpful for her.
She's fought a handful of times here in the U.S., so not new to fighting here stateside, and I think that experience is important to get comfortable in the States. I mean, you know that better than anyone, Megan. You know, hailing from Australia, taking your career here, it's all about adapting and being comfortable in your surroundings, and, you know, Begley hopes to shine in that comfortable environment here fighting in Boston.
100%, and when we spoke to her earlier this week, she's like, I am so excited to be here. A little bit of nerves, but that's going to come with any fight. You know, anyone who tells you they don't have any nerves, they've either been fighting for 30-odd years, or they might be, you know, a little screw loose, possibly. But with Dee, she really had some comfort for this one, fighting on the same card as her teammate in Danni. She's like, I haven't really fought on cards with teammates for a very long time. She's like, maybe when she was an amateur back in the day, but it's been a long time since she's been able to have the familiarity of a team environment in fight week.
Can you confirm the fighters have a screw loose, Julie Kenson?
Well, I did.
I think we all have to.
I mean, to get locked in the cage with another professional athlete that is trying to kill you, yeah.
I think you have to be crazy to make beautiful art, TJ.
Well said, Julie Kenson. Kristina Williams, they call her the War Horse, making the walk for the fourth time in her Invicta FC run. A former title challenger. We talk about the experience. She hopes to shine with that experience tonight. You are looking at the War Horse, Kristina Williams. Again, making her fourth Invicta appearance tonight. She has a title fight under her belt. She believes a win tonight, Megan, can put her back in that title picture.
Exactly, and the flyweight title right now is vacant.
Right.
So this is very much whoever wins will probably, I mean, I can't say 100% because that's above my pay grade, and my name's not Shannon Knapp, but I would say the winner will definitely have a very significant horse in the race, pun intended, for being one half of that title fight for the flyweight division.
War Horse, I saw what you did. That's good.
Try,
that's
I
good.
Try.
All right, this is our co-main event. For more on it, let's take a look at this.
Ireland native Dee Begley has put the flyweight division on notice. With multiple world and European medals in kickboxing, she's considered one of the sport's most dangerous strikers. Now, coming off an impressive first-round submission win, opponents will need to fear her ground game as well. Tonight in Boston, Begley hopes that the luck of the Irish will push her to be victorious in her Invicta FC debut.
Holding an Invicta title would just be kind of a culmination of years of hard work and just put me on the map as, you know, the best female MMA fighter in the world.
Ready to take on that challenge is MMA veteran Kristina Warhorse Williams. Representing American Elite MMA, Williams has earned 6 wins since turning pro, including finishes by both knockout and submission. Tonight, she'll be on the hunt for another stoppage victory.
The fans are gonna see a lot of striking, hopefully some blood, and a really good show. I want to strike heavy and make an exciting fight.
flyweights are ready to fight here inside the Invicta FC cage. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape. The American, the warhorse, Kristina Williams, 6 years the elder of Ireland's D. Begley. Williams stands 5 inches taller. She will have a 7.5-inch reach advantage. For the official introductions of this co-main event, here is Joe Martinez.
And now, fight fans, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. 3 rounds this scheduled in the flyweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. At 5'3" tall, this mixed martial artist weighed in officially 126 pounds. In 6 fights, her record stands at 4 victories with 2 defeats. Fighting out of and representing Dublin, Ireland, here is D. And across the cage stands her opponent, fighting out of the red corner. A Brazilian jiu-jitsu practitioner standing 5'8" tall, weighing at officially 125.5 pounds. In 10 fights, her record stands at 6 victories with 4 defeats. Fighting out of Edmond, Oklahoma, here is Kristina Warhorse Williams. And your referee in charge of the action is John English.
John English getting our co-main event assignment. It is the American warhorse Kristina Williams taking on Ireland's D. Begley. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson live tonight inside the House of Blues in Boston, Massachusetts. Our co-main event is underway. This fight is brought to you by Punch Gunk, pain relief and recovery, trusted by the toughest athletes on earth. The war horse, Kristina Williams, taking the center of the Invicta FC cage here to start.
See, Begley, definitely the shorter fighter, definitely the shorter reach, but she said, yeah, I'm used to everybody being taller than me. It doesn't stop me.
War horse comes high with that right kick.
Nice side kick there.
Bit of a feeling out period between these two to start off this fight.
Or not.
Two head kicks and a hook.
In case of anything you can do, I can do better as they exchange low kicks.
Now Williams, when we spoke to her, she said in her last fight timing was a big issue in that one, and she didn't pull the trigger when she needed to, and she didn't really feel her rhythm. That's one thing that she wanted to rectify this fight. She wanted to be a sniper in there, see everything, react to everything, and really, do some damage with those elbows, Julie.
Yeah, both of them really getting in each other's faces. Yeah, something Williams told us is like her last fight in that bid for the title that she lost to Souza, she spent more time on the ground there than she had in quite a while.
And high again with that kick. 2 minutes down here in this opening round.
Begley's hands are a bit low, but she also shows no reaction to getting hit.
Yeah, with that reach advantage on the side of Williams, Begley still seems pretty comfortable standing and exchanging here.
Ooh, big overhand. Williams also staying very, very calm.
When you watch a lot of Begley's previous fights, she loves that big overhand right. She utilizes that at times to close the range. I'd like to see her do that right now as she closes the range.
Yep, double jab to double underhooks for Begley, dropping her level, but Williams said she's been working on her wrestling big time.
We talk about that reach advantage and the height for Williams. That can be a factor in the clinch as well, right, Megan?
It can be, because her center of gravity is slightly higher. So for Begley, who is looking to shoot in underneath that, you know, it can be a little easier to kind of, you know, disrupt that center of gravity because she's already underneath. You know, it's something that a lot of taller fighters have to be very cognizant of when they're fighting somebody shorter who's looking to close that range and grapple.
A lot of confidence here on display by the Warhorse, Kristina Williams, able to keep this fight at space.
The kicks are just absolutely loud from here. We're just hearing swack, swack to the leg.
And Williams has done a good job with those kicks. Oh, it's a hard front kick to the face, though, by Begley.
Very beautiful.
By Begley. Now she spins.
And I was going to mention, she's pulling back a little bit too much on her right, and then she uses that pullback to throw that spin back fist there.
Now, Williams in her face, though, you know, trying to get hers back, but Begley's starting to find her moments here in the first.
45 seconds left here in this opening round. Williams back to the body with that left kick. You almost feel you or find yourself holding your breath here in this fight. I mean, huge moments in any moment.
Overhanded tie-up.
We can see exactly that. Big right hand and then into the clinch. Begley trying to get this fight to the floor.
Now, she's got double unders, but she's a little high up around the armpits with those double unders, so it's going to be a little bit more difficult. Williams looking to take the back if this does go to the ground.
Oh, there's the hook.
Time not on her side. We are headed to round number two in our co-main event. Live from Boston, it's Invicta FC. Round one of our co-main events in the books. Julie, walk us through some of this action.
Well, I mean, we're seeing a lot of high kicks, a lot of overhands, and real some viciousness right on the inside from both of these fighters. Kristina Williams, I think, had the upper hand when it came to those round kicks. She was able to work the leg, work the head, but Begley with that beautiful teep to the face. I love seeing that. I love seeing that creativity and that overhand. But Williams really, really pushed forward. She did a nice job of staying composed. And at the end of this round, when they were tied up against the fence, she showed great composure getting her hooks in.
We're back live in Boston inside the House of Blues, our co-main event, headed into round number two. It is the Warhorse, Kristina Williams, taking on Ireland's Dee Begley. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson. Appreciate you joining us tonight for Invicta FC 54.
It's something you can see from Dee Begley's entire demeanor. This woman loves to fight. She just loves to fight. Ooh.
Oh, that one hurt.
Hard shot.
Williams coming forward, trying to turn up the heat.
She
on what looked
to
appear to be an injured Dee Begley.
No, she smells the blood there. You know, visibly reacted to that body kick, but and that's been the theme for Kristina Williams in this fight is the kicking game. To the legs, to the head, to the body. She's mixing them up so well that she's posing so many different threats for Dee Begley to have to decipher, you know, in the moment.
Julie, we see fighters get rocked and rattled all the time by strikes, but when you get hit to the body, what's that recovery time like? Are you able to recover the same when you get clipped on the chin?
It depends on where you're hit. If you get hit in the liver hard enough, your entire body kind of freezes up and shuts down, and it's almost a delayed response. But what's interesting is Begley opened this round with a liver kick and then got that shot from Williams. Ooh, nice hard shot again from Williams.
We saw Williams, you know, try to turn up the heat, but it happened so early. I think it was smart for her to disengage a little bit and not get overzealous with her aggression.
Absolutely. And what we're seeing also with her kicks is that kick for kick, like she's so fast that when, you know, whenever Begley kicks her, she's able to strike back really fast and almost on the off balance. Not quite. Begley's getting her composure.
And you can't get overzealous, I think, with someone like Begley, who we've already seen be dynamic with her striking. She's not afraid to spin, and she'll also TP in the face.
And she's hard to put away. She's not going to go down easily. So, and like you said, TJ, it was smart of Williams to be able to disengage, pick her shots, and look to counter that aggression of Begley as she looks to push the pace.
Now inside this clinch.
As Begley tries to go for that double leg against the fence, Williams is doing a nice job with that inserted left hand. She's, you know, getting that underhook, and she's staying calm, looking to reverse there. Begley's fighting hands now, and also still her head's down a little bit low for my taste there.
Williams had a Kimura grip there for just a brief moment. Able to make some space now, back at the center.
We've seen Williams be aggressive. I mean, she's a great fighter, and that's why she earned that title shot. But right now, I think she's on fire.
She's just showing a lot more maturity in her game, the well-roundedness, the elevation of her game. And her last fight for the title was the first at a new camp. Now she's had a little bit more time at that new gym, that new camp, that, you know, she's really been able to put a lot of those pieces together, and we're seeing it on display right now.
You know, they say in the sport you either win or you learn, and for Kristina Williams, obviously all hard right hand, but the warhorse still coming forward. I mean, that landed flush by D. Begley.
And I'd like to see Begley, you know, double, triple up on those combinations. She's only really throwing one punch at a time.
Oh, another liver shot.
My goodness.
The warhorse coming forward. Begley in a bit of survival mode. Again, kicking the body is Williams. Touch over a minute remaining here in round number two. You talk about the heart of Begley's teammates and Danni McCormack. Begley showing some heart of her own here in our co-main event.
Oh, nice spin there to the tie-up, but Williams is on to it.
Really impressed with the ability by Begley to recover like that. It looked like she was hurt badly to the body. 30 seconds here left, and now trying to get that back.
Oh, that head and arm choke attempt throw. That always irks me, because this is exactly what happens if you don't do it exactly right. You leave the hooks open, you leave the back open, and now Kristina Williams on her back looking for that rear naked choke.
Short time here, touch over 10 seconds left to work here.
Begley is no stranger to ground fighting. She received her purple belt last Christmas, she tells us. She's doing a nice job of trying to turn in.
Nice bit of survival on display for D. Begley. Able to outlast the striking offense of the warhorse. Kristina Williams on the feet, looked like she had her hurt multiple times, and then things got a little bit dicey with that rear naked choke attempt to end the round, but she's not going anywhere, and like her teammate Danni McCormack, D. Begley very hard to put away, Megan.
100%, but she also has only 5 minutes left to win this fight, and you know, I feel like she's down. She's down two rounds on the scorecard. I want to see some urgency. I want to see her, you know, throwing some higher volume. You know, she's doing well in the exchanges, but it's the volume, the pressure, the range control of Williams that seems to be, you know, a little much for Begley at times. Now, Begley is having moments, but they're too far between for her to really start garnering momentum and having success in this fight.
And she needs to make those moments, you know, really count, and not just land one strike, Julie, but land with volume.
Land with volume. You know, she's done that beautiful double roundhouse kick, low high. Something I learned in my Taekwondo days that I could never get my leg to do again. But she's not following through enough with her hands.
Third round underway tomorrow. Heavy Metal Halloween is back and better than ever, beginning at 5 Eastern on Access TV. Unwrap some candy and rock out with Alice Cooper, Judas Priest, Black Sabbath, and the documentary premiere of Metal Massacre at 9 Eastern. Bang your head!
if you dare. Now inside the clinch here is Dee Begley.
Once again, she has the double underhooks. Once again, Kristina Williams is climbing for that back. She's able to insert that left hook.
Well, Begley's just too high, Julie. She's up around the armpits, which is giving Kristina Williams the opportunity to pop out the back and take her back. Now, you know, Begley needs to readjust that height. You know, go down towards the hips.
Mm-hmm. And that's... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, and Williams isn't going to be able to take the back if her center of gravity is slightly lower.
Relentless with this takedown attempt is Begley. Now she gets it to the floor inside the closed guard of the warhorse Kristina Williams.
And this is a good opportunity for Begley, if she stays composed, to throw some real fire, some big overhands using gravity to help. But Williams has those legs and she's climbing that high guard. You do not want your butt up and your head down against Williams.
And stacking up inside this closed guard is Dee Begley. Quick hammer fist makes some space. He goes back to the floor.
Good hips there.
You mentioned that Begley probably down here. Megan, how aggressive would you like to see her here on the floor?
Obviously, without putting herself in a position to be submitted or the position reverse, but I want to see some urgency. Like, look to pass the guard. Look to do some damage, because this, while she's positionally winning, this isn't going to win her the fight right now. Like, Dee Begley needs a finish if she wants to win this fight.
Staying busy here in this guard, stacking is Begley, with that high guard on display here of Kristina Williams. Halfway point here of round number three.
She's got to really stay glued to Williams' hips and keep control of those hands. If Williams, you know, Williams has great opportunities here to spin around, to get that sweep, to get that armbar or that triangle. Begley staying very composed, though. You see, Williams has that wrist trapped. Oh, big shots there from Begley.
Kicking her away is Williams, now back to her feet. Big right hand, back to the clinch goes Begley.
I'd like to see her hips closer on that takedown, TJ. She does leave herself a little bit exposed, but she was able to get the takedown there before, so maybe I'll just shut up.
I would never tell you to shut up, Julie.
Yeah, but just the fans. Now, Williams is trying to isolate Begley's right arm, but it looks like she's, pretty isolated there. Nice job on Begley, staying composed.
And Williams doing a really good job of disrupting the posture of Begley. You know, instead of Begley having, you know, real strong through her spine and through her head, Williams is doing a good job of breaking that and really putting pressure on that neck.
Begley switches from the double leg to the single leg, and Williams is able to push through that. Both legs on the ground now. Working her counter cage wrestling.
Williams able to make space, now back in range.
Oh, big right hand by Begley.
And you can see her left leg is really eaten up by a lot of those kicks, but she continues, I was gonna say to push forward, but obviously she's a little bit backed up now.
Begley needs something big here as we come down the stretch. Volume thrown by Williams here inside the final 30 seconds. Hard punches here by the Warhorse.
What a strong finish here for Kristina Williams.
What a fight.
Oh my.
We go 15 full here in our co-main event. Our official decision coming up next.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the scorecards, and here are the totals. Judge Deacon scores it 29-28 for Begley. Judge Mahmoud, 29-28 for Williams. And Judge Cardelli has it 29-28 for your winner by split decision, Kristina Warhorse Williams.
I'm here with Kristina Warhorse Williams. When we spoke to you earlier this week, you said mentally you needed a win to kind of get back on your feet, and you wanted a win for your team.
Yes.
You know, you put on an amazing performance, you got the win. How good does this one feel, not only for yourself, but for the team around you?
It's amazing. My team at Killer Bees Kickboxing has just put in so much work with me and my coach, Mike Giroux. I'm so happy to bring this back to them.
Well, you put on a 15-minute performance, the kicking game, the range control, and you really elevated your game as a fighter. Did you see this fight going to a split decision, or did you feel like you kind of did enough to have all three rounds?
I think that I slacked a little on the wall control, but I think my striking was highly above hers. So I think that I should have come out at least unanimous.
Well, the 125-pound belt is currently vacant here at Invicta. I know you just recently fought against Ketlin Souza a couple of months ago. Do you want another chance at that belt? And if so, who do you want to fight for the championship?
I'll literally fight anybody. I definitely am up for that. Definitely fight anybody for it.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Kristina Warhorse Williams.
It's been phenomenal thus far. Our main event still on deck, but the action we've seen throughout, you can expect the unexpected, Megan, when it comes to Invicta FC Fight Night. And these athletes are delivering once again. Phenomenal co-main event, Kristina Williams. Split decision, maybe a one-way traffic for a split decision a bit, but Dee Begley was definitely game.
They both were game, and you know what I love is, prior to Invicta FC 54, I think we've only had one finish over all of the fights that we've had so far this year, and we've already got two back-to-back first round rear naked choke finishes and two absolutely impressive performances by Maria Djukic. And both Kristina Williams and Dee Begley put on an absolute war.
Yeah, absolutely. We talk about our decisions. I mean, these aren't boring decisions by any means. Both athletes in our decisions on the winning and losing side were very game. We saw that with Maria Djukic, who got her first Invicta win over Brazil's Fernanda Araujo. But it's all about the finishes, and we got that back-to-back with Radrally Martinez and Andrea Amaro. Julie, what can you ask more for than a first-round sub?
I mean, yeah, you can't ask more than from a first-round sub. Maybe a first-round, I'd love to see a first-round knockout as well, TJ. But you have to say about those fights that went to the decision, that was Kick City.
Yeah.
That was fantastic. In both of those fights, in the Djukic Araujo fight and in the Kristina Williams Dee Begley fight, we're seeing some kicking tonight.
Absolutely.
It seems to be a theme tonight. It's the kicking game. But it's not just, you know, the leg kicks. Look at Kristina Williams. The way that she so effortlessly mixed it up, the head, the body, the leg. She's going to the leg to disrupt the movement of Begley. But then she's going to the head, but then she's going to the body, and she's doing damage and visibly hurting Begley in those instances. I mean, that is what you want to see from a young fighter like Kristina Williams, who kind of came up short in her last bout for the title. She went away, she's had some time now, and the way that she's been able to elevate her game and continually improve is so impressive to see.
No, absolutely. Our Strawweight main event coming up a little bit later, but it's been a phenomenal night thus far. Speaking of phenomenal moments here at Invicta FC, take a look at some of the best moments of 2023. It is going to be a great night of fights. Heart in this cage.
Oh, oh my goodness!
That nose is bleeding out.
Both sides throwing hands. Whoa. And there's a staggering right hand.
Oh, this lovely. Works. Oh, my goodness.
And going for the takedown now.
Beautiful.
Big right hand. Oh, my goodness.
Unbelievable. This is Invicta FC.
Coming up next, it's our main event of the evening, as the Polish assassin Karolina Wójcik looks to strike Invicta FC gold when she takes on the strawweight champion in Ireland's mad Danni McCormack. It's a battle for strawweight supremacy, and it's next. You're watching Invicta FC.
We are set for our strawweight title fight. It is our main event, the champion, Danni Mac, Danni McCormack. Julie, she looks to pen the first chapter of that championship legacy. We know she has heart for days. We'll see if she needs to rely on that heart against the Polish assassin.
She has heart for days, but she also has a really good mind for combat, TJ. You know, when you listen to her talk about fights and break them down, she is smart.
We'll see what she can do against the Polish assassin, and it's a rematch beginning.
It is 6 years in the making, like we kind of mentioned earlier, but Wójcik is just, you know, she's an assassin. She gets in there, she picks her shots, she picks her moments, she's absolutely relentless. The volume, the pressure, the tenacity of both of these ladies, I have no doubt that this fight is going to be absolute fire.
And it comes down to tactics in fights like this. When you're standing across the cage from someone who has championship experience like Wójcik does, you need to make those adjustments. And largely, Julie, a lot of the winners in these types of fights come down to who makes those the better tactical adjustments between rounds.
I mean, yeah, that's all violence and combat, right? It's about, you know, when you're faced with adversity, it's how you respond to it. And again, going back to Danni McCormack's title fight, dropped twice in the first round, made the adjustments, and would not stop fighting. Now, Karolina Wójcik, oh, she is so fast, and this small cage actually might benefit her tonight.
Well, it's organized chaos for Karolina Wójcik. You know, she is so, she's like a tornado. She gets in there, and it's just like a whole, you know, barrage of punches, grappling, takedown attempts, and then she's out of range. She's looking to counter, and, you know, it'll be interesting to see how they approach this fight. Because when you look at that Danni McCormack fight against Valeska Machado, she followed Machado around the cage instead of cutting it off, and she was countered a lot, and she was made to pay consistently for that. I wouldn't be surprised if Wójcik tries to take this similar approach, because Wójcik is very much a counter-striker in her own right.
A counter-striker, but one with a lot of speed.
The Invicta FC Strawweight Championship is on the line when Poland's Karolina Wójcik challenges the champion in Ireland's Danni McCormack. The Polish assassin Karolina Wójcik returns tonight after an impressive win over Ediana Silva. A pressure fighter, Wójcik grinds on her opponents, a style which has earned her an impressive 11-3 record. Now she has her sights set on minting herself the world strawweight champion, with only Danni McCormack standing in her way.
Game plan is just win. I can't say what you will do. You will see tomorrow night.
Ireland's mad Danni McCormack has different plans, currently holding the strawweight belt, a title that has only been successfully defended once. McCormack will look to cement her championship status by picking up her first title defense. Riding a two-fight win streak, with both wins coming in dominant fashion, McCormack has been flawless since joining Invicta FC,
And tonight, she stands ready to pen the first chapter of her championship legacy.
What do they say? To be the champion, you must defend. You can't just win the belt, you gotta defend too. So I want to be remembered as one of the best strawweight Invicta world champions there ever was. So I will defend it. I'll get my two title runs.
The strawweight championship of the world is on the line. And the Polish assassin is making the walk as she hunts for the crown against a familiar foe. These two women met previously as amateurs, and while their styles vegan may be similar to when they first met, safe to say both of these women have evolved tenfold since their first meeting.
100%, you know, when they first fought as amateurs, you know, Karolina was very well established in the amateur scene in Europe. Now, both Danni and Karolina have had so much success as professionals and as amateurs that I love that we're seeing this rematch now and not too early on in their pro careers. They both had a lot of success. They've both proven their worth as competitors. And now the stakes are at its highest with gold on the line, TJ.
You know, when you look at that first meeting, obviously we talk about the evolution, but if their strategies are similar, can either fighter really pull from that first meeting, you know, so long ago and implement it tonight?
No, because, you know, like any fighter will tell you, the fighter that I was 6 months ago to now is completely different. The fighter that I was 3 months ago to now is completely different, let alone 6 years.
Right.
You know, there's so much growth in this sport. This is a game of constant evolution. It constantly growing. If you don't keep up with the changes, you get left behind. And both of these women are just doggedly determined to be competitors at the highest level. And their goal is to just elevate themselves to the next level and showcase how good they each really are.
The Polish assassin hopes to become Invicta's first Polish champion tonight, when she takes on Danni Mac, Danni McCormack. Danni McCormack is the reigning, defending, undisputed strawweight champion of the world. And there's that old saying, Julie, you're not really the champion until you defend your belt. Well, it sounds like Danni McCormack wants to do more than just defend tonight here in Boston.
Oh, absolutely. And don't tell her that, because she says, I am in heart of a champion. I am a champion. I will always be a champion. And I will hold on to this belt, you know, until they rip it away from me. And I know Wójcik's trying to do that tonight, but what a performance by Danni McCormack. You know, I think about moments, I guess, I get too emotional about this, but that, I was crying my eyes out that fight. Because
we all were.
Oh, she and Valesa Machado, both fantastic fighters, but it is that absolute will that Danni McCormack showed that night, that refusal to quit, and, you know, that ability to make adjustments, as we talked about in that fight.
The heart of a lion, Julie.
She recently did an interview with Sean Sheehan, and one of the things she said was, this is one of the best things I've ever heard. She said, yeah, when I got up the second time, I knew she was effing mine, that I had it. Like, you don't hear somebody say that after knocked down two times. She's like, that's it. I knew it was mine. I knew this was going to be my fight, and it certainly was.
The mental toughness that she brings to the cage, and it's, you very rarely ever see it shown so impressively as when Danni McCormack gets in the cage and she fights every single time. It might not look pretty, but it's raw.
All right, our main event set to get underway. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for this strawweight championship bout. Danni McCormack, 33 years old, the elder of the Polish woman. It is Karolina Wójcik at 28. 5'4" is McCormack, and we are official for the title, as both weighed in under the 115-pound limit. For our championship introductions, we go to Joe Martinez. Championship about to be on the line here in our main event. Danni Mac, Danni McCormack hopes to make a statement in her first title defense when she takes on again a familiar foe. and the Polish assassin, Karolina Wójcik. Wójcik has a ton of experience fighting at the highest level, and tonight she hopes to reach the highest accolade in capturing an Invicta FC title. In order to do that, she will have to take it from the first woman to claim gold here at Invicta FC from Ireland. We think about Irish champions, you have to think about Conor McGregor, a teammate of Danni McCormack. And of McCormack, Conor said, she's a proper fighter. I like that. You know, a lot can be said in minimalistic words, and Conor McGregor said it all right there.
I love that expression, TJ. I mean, what is a proper fighter but one that just will not quit, will not let go?
Definitely has the heart of a champion. If all goes well for her, she won't have to call upon that heart, but we'll see what happens as she's taking on a very tough Polish assassin. All right, we are set now for our championship introductions. We go to Joe Martinez.
For the Invicta FC Strawweight Championship of the World. And is presented by Fortune Restel and Proper 12 Irish Whiskey. Sanctioned by the Massachusetts State Athletic Commission, the three judges scoring at cake side, Mike Cardarone, Jen Dickens, and Nicholas Mahmoud. And for the action begins inside the cage, the referee in charge, Kevin McDonald. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the judges are ready and the fighters are ready. Boston, make some noise if you! The judges will be your first fighter in the blue corner. This mixed martial artist is 5 feet 2 inches tall, weighing in officially 114 and 1 quarter pounds in 14 fights. Her record stands at 11 victories with 3 defeats. Here is the strawweight title challenger from Krakow, Poland. Introducing the Polish assassin, Karolina Wójcik. And across the game stands her opponent, fighting in the red corner. This mixed martial artist is 5 feet 4 inches tall, with an official length 114 and 1/2 pounds. In 9 fights, her record stands at 7 victories with 2 defeats. She is the fighting pride of Dublin, Ireland. Here is
our main event is set. Referee Kevin McDonald getting the assignment. Strawweight Championship of the World is on the line as the Polish assassin takes on that woman, Danni McCormack, the reigning defending strawweight queen. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson, live tonight inside the House of Blues in Boston, Massachusetts, the site of Invicta FC 54. Wójcik taking the center of the cage. She wears the black. Wearing the Ireland colors is Danni McCormack. Inside the clinch here to start things early.
Doesn't even throw a strike to get there. Just kind of wades right into it. That's exactly what you want to do against somebody who's that fast, TJ. You want to pin them, make sure that they can't get their range.
Pushing it against the face here is the challenger.
Megan and I asked McCormack what a perfect fight would be for her. She's like, to take her down, mount her, and finish her with elbows in the first round.
Back at space. McCormack captured the crown, ripping it away from Valeska Machado in a fight that she really had to dig deep in order to take. And her face was just an absolute mess.
Oh,
no question,
nice.
She's ready to go to war. And doing so right now. Wojcik inside the clinch.
Doing a great job there. You know, it looked like she kind of stumbled a little bit from one of those strikes from McCormack. So smart decision from Karolina to close that range and really, you know, take a breath here and get her wits back about her.
Gets the takedown there. She was able to get underneath the arm and just kind of tempered to the ground very nicely. Now Wójcik looking to take the back, looking to get those hooks in.
That left hook in for the Polish assassin. McCormack back to her feet, trying to fight the hands here. Two minutes down here in this opening round of our strawweight championship fight.
See McCormack trying to scrape her on the cage, insert her left elbow to the inside to turn in to be chest to chest.
And really just trying to dig that, her own underhook. But Karolina's doing a really good job of preventing that from happening. But you know, McCormack able to square back up here in the first. Wójcik isn't really giving her a lot of space, Julie.
She's not.
To kind of circle off.
It's true, and she's also countering the counterfighter narrative by getting in there and, you know, tying up right away.
McCormack able to get off the fence, see if she can get away from this clinch.
We've seen McCormack do some very smart things on the fence in her previous fight. But yeah, it's really interesting to see how this is playing out so far.
You know, and when we've spoken to McCormack before, she said, sometimes I need to be hit a couple times for me to get going, much to my coach's dismay.
Well, I can understand that, but I can also understand the coach's point of view. You don't want your fighter to get hit.
I was going to say that sounds like a proper fighter. Willing to engage, take a couple to give a couple.
Oh, and now McCormack joins the back. Very nice. Did you feel that way sometimes, Megan? You had to be hit?
Sometimes, yeah. It's like I needed to be woken up a couple times.
Yeah.
I mean, when you get hit by a man and you just, listen, no one wants to be woken up by that. 10 out of 10 would not recommend. She's the GOAT for the reason, for a reason. But Danni McCormack is looking, you know, very strong here in the first round.
Very
fast started. She's starting very fast.
Oh, good tie up to the high crotch. Very smart. Again, she's a smart fighter, and Wójcik may have taken her off her game just a bit by not being a counter fighter there, but the adjustments, like you guys were talking about.
Inside the final minute of this opening round, we talk about those adjustments. You know, both women have had moments here, but this is a sport very much of what have you done for me lately, and this is a big statement as we head down the stretch of this opening round for McCormack to be in control after, you know, having to be defensive a bit earlier in this fight.
Exactly, and you know, we talk about making adjustments, and a lot of fighters make those in between rounds, right, when they go back to the corner. But the marker of a really smart fighter is those who can do that mid-round, like during the fight. And we're seeing McCormack do that right here. She's making those adjustments, and it's really starting to pay off as she's tying up Wójcik here and really just putting the pressure on.
Final 10 seconds of this opening round. Strawweight Championship of the World is on the line. Danni McCormack taking on Karolina Wójcik. You're watching Invicta FC. Julie, walk us through some of the action.
Well, I mean, we saw that early stumble. We saw actually the early tie-up from McCormack, but then we saw Wójcik turn the tide and actually tie up with her and get the takedown there, try for the back. They finished out the round. Wójcik kind of went into, I'm going to be fast bunny striker mode, and Danni McCormack really reading on it. But I think Danni McCormack got that shot that woke her up there at the end. I think she's mad now.
Thank you.
Our main event presented by Forge Irish Stout and Proper Number 12 Irish Whiskey. Round two underway. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson. Live tonight in Boston inside the House of Blues, the site of Invicta FC 54. See the champion, Danni McCormack, in the colors of Ireland, taking on the Polish assassin in Karolina Wójcik. Light on her feet is the challenger. Coming forward with some strikes is Wójcik. Megan, your thoughts on round number one?
I feel like it was a very close round. I think the start of the round, Karolina had a lot of success, but towards the second half of the round, Danni McCormack really started to find her rhythm, find her timing, and just really start putting it on and pushing the pace a little more.
Putting this fight back in the clinch is Wójcik. Able to reverse the position up against the fence is McCormack, now back in space.
Now the physicality of McCormack in these clinch exchanges is definitely showing. She's bought some real estate in the center of the octagon right here, and she's not allowing Wójcik to really reclaim any of that. It's like monopoly.
We're also seeing some really fantastic lightning fast right hooks from the champion and those beautiful left kicks to the head. Not landing with tons of power, but so well, that was pretty hard, but super fast. We talked about the speed demon in the Polish assassin, but you know, both of these young ladies are extremely fast, extremely technical fighters.
The strawweight weight division has been one of my favorite over the many years, and you know, because of the talent being so rich, we haven't seen this title defended too often. Only been defended one time by a few women to hold this belt, but you know, you capture this championship title, and it's one that catapults you to some of the biggest fights you're ever going to have in your career.
Ooh, nice jab there. There's the tie-up attempt again from McCormack.
You know, McCormack is looking to close that range, but she's not really setting that up, and she's allowing Karolina Wójcik to counter her as she tries to close that range for those takedowns, Julie.
And I'm halfway liking point. The leg kick. Excuse me, TJ.
No, halfway point of round number two. McCormack now into the clinch.
One of the things McCormack said about their amateur bout that she dropped to the Polish assassin was that, yeah, it was 9 minutes of me chasing her, but I realized how much I love MMA, how much I love fighting in those 9 minutes. Wójcik trying to control the bicep there. Smart thing to do in that clinch. Opens up a lot of possibilities, and there's that head control I love.
The grinding here with that head position is the Irish woman, Danni McCormack.
We'll see if she can do anything with this control here. She looks to separate and strike, or she looks to kind of level change and go for a takedown, but Wójcik looking like she's having some issues with that head control of McCormack here.
And while it doesn't look like there's a lot of action here, this is grueling and grinding for a fighter to, you know, wear that pressure of your opponent, you know, caught in a tough position like this.
Yeah, you want to...
Exhausting.
Yeah, you want to critique cage fighting, go try it. It is exhausting, it is technical, it is a game of inches, and it's a real hard thing to get right. Both of them are doing a pretty good job of it. Both of them have had their moments on there, but McCormack is definitely turning up the heat and the power right here.
Well, McCormack just making Wójcik wear her weight, carry her weight. And, you know, in these instances, while it is grueling, it is slightly more grueling for Wójcik in these instances because she's having to wear the weight of McCormack. She's having to defend these takedown attempts, defend, you know, these movements, but she's doing a really good job of pushing on the head and separating there. And we'll see if either is able to really have success at range here in the second.
And you mentioned that. Well, there's another team to the face tonight. All right, guys. You mentioned that the push off, she pushed under the chin, which is a smart thing to do against a taller fighter.
Yeah. Round two in the books of our main event strawweight title on the line between McCormack and Wójcik. Ten minutes down. Megan, your thoughts on what we've seen thus far, and what adjustments would you like to see the Polish assassin make as we head into round number three?
This fight is such a close fight. This game is a game of inches, and it's really, this second round particularly was the pressure of McCormack. I think that was the theme of this round. Wójcik, you know, looking to counter, has some success, but I think it was the octagon control and the control in the cage of McCormack that really has success, and that team kick opened up the nose of Wójcik, and you know, look at it there, it's definitely broken. I can attest to that, having broken my nose in a fight before. It's not a pleasant experience. And you know, moving forward into this fight, her breathing is now compromised. So we'll see how this plays out in the next couple rounds.
You gotta make sure not to blow that nose either. I think you're real bad real quick.
Real bad, real quick.
So I've heard.
We can see McCormack touching her nose as well. I wonder if she's had memories of how badly her nose was broken when she won the title. So that will not necessarily prevent you from getting the win.
Round three underway. Check out the new hit series on Access TV. Spin 100 Greatest Rock Stars airs every Monday night at 8 Eastern. Spin Magazine's list of 100 Greatest Rock Stars, celebrities, the musicians that shaped rock and roll. Who's on your list? Two rock stars going to work here in our main event. Danni McCormack closing the distance now, trying to get Wójcik up against the fence. She does.
We can level change and snatch up a single. And Wójcik has her right arm scooped underneath right there, which is smart to do at range. But now that McCormack is so close, keeping that arm underneath, not great. It actually opens up takedown possibilities.
Well, sometimes though, like as McCormack goes to drop, if you're able to catch the chin on her way down, you're able to use that as a lever to kind of elevate the chin of the person going for the takedown. So huge leg kick there.
Ooh, now some hard shots there by way of punches from Wójcik.
You know, Wójcik's landed a lot of hard right hands so far in this round.
You know, what I loved when we spoke to Danni McCormack earlier this week is she said, I will be caught dead being in a boring fight. I'd rather someone throw in the towel than ever be in a boring fight. I'm going to make Karolina Wójcik fight. I'm going to force her to fight. And that is exactly what we're seeing right now.
Which can be a dangerous proposition when you're fighting someone that's a counter fighter. If you get too aggressive, you're sort of playing in their game. But so far, so good for McCormack, who is definitely making this a fight.
And given how much Wójcik has landed that right hand, I think that check hook, that right check hook from McCormack needs to be coming out right now. She needs to be taking that angle a bit more.
A tough fight here for both women, both having their moments. You know, so far, Julie, we're approaching the halfway point of this fight. You know, optics-wise, who do you think is looking better than the judges at this point?
Oh, don't ask me that, TJ. I'm too excited to watch this. Okay. I just want to see the violence.
It's a coin flip. You know, I think, you know, Karolina Wójcik is having success, and she's having success with that counter-striking, but the forward pressure of McCormack is a lot. It is a lot when you're in there, and it's really comes down to how the judges score that type of pressure.
Right.
That was an excellent read there from Wójcik when McCormack tried for that takedown, hitting for the knee and the shot right afterwards. That's where her speed and her counter, oh, wow, that was a nice shot. That's where her speed and counter fight really works to her advantage, hitting on the half beat.
Nice. McCormack comes high with that left head kick. Now back into the clinch.
Beautiful entry there on that takedown.
That was magical, beautiful timing right there.
And you know, you talk about the scoring criteria. This fight is so even that a lot of moments like this where you're controlling your opponent up against the fence,
I mean, that's what the judges may eventually find themselves scoring the entire round upon.
Right, and particularly if both of them are kind of evenly scored in the striking department and one of them isn't really doing, you know, having the more damaging strikes at the end of the round. Like you said, TJ, it's going to come down to moments like this. So, you know, this is very smart by Danni McCormack to mix things like this in so it's not so back and forth. There's that check hook, Julie.
I love it. You know, something about Danni McCormack, I was mentioning that she is a smart fighter. She's also a coach in her own right. So she's able to break things down. Of course, she has a fantastic team and fantastic teammates to work with and help with that as well. And she and her husband own an MMA gym called Relentless MMA in Mullingar.
Living up to that name is Danni McCormack.
But Wójcik is game. That right hand is starting to find a lot of success in this third round. You know, McCormack is so determined to close that range and being aggressive that her head isn't coming off the center line. Her head is a target for Wójcik, and Wójcik is doing exactly what Valeska Machado did in their fight back in March. She's circling off, and as Danni walks in to chase her, she's countering with that big right hand. She's having success.
That right hand is money for Wójcik. And you're right about the head control. Danny's really not moving her head enough.
Three rounds down in our championship main event. Danni McCormack defending against the Polish assassin and Karolina Wójcik. I was going to ask you, Julie, who might be up on the scorecards, but I know better than to do that. But
I'm half Irish, half Polish.
Okay, wow.
My soul's at war right now, TJ.
But I mean, it's a very entertaining fight, and you know, when you have athletes at the highest level, sometimes tactics can outweigh entertainment, but walk us through the action. This has been very entertaining, to say
the least. I think this was a very strong round for Wójcik. She did get off balance and kind of dropped with that kick, but she landed many right hands. Now, Danni McCormack, I'm loving that leg kick from her. She's got to be careful with the body kick there because Wójcik is definitely looking to tie her up, get in close, and rattle up. One thing they do is grab each other's heads and hit. They both have that in common, and I love watching that.
We are headed into the championship rounds. Megan, your thoughts on the optics of this fight. What would you be telling either fighter as we head into round number 4?
I mean, for Danni McCormack, I'd like to see her be a little bit less aggressive with that forward pressure and look to get her head off the center line. For Wójcik, she's starting to really have some success. You know, keep doing what she's doing. Don't let McCormack bully her with her size. You know, look to counter. Look to, you know, not let McCormack close that range and tie her up on the cage.
Fourth round underway. Strawweight Championship of the World on the line as Danni McCormack is defending against Karolina Wójcik. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson live tonight inside the House of Blues in Boston, Massachusetts, the site of Invicta FC 54.
One thing we're seeing McCormack do is circle to her left quite a bit, and that is a dangerous thing against a right-handed fighter. You really have to keep a good shield for that.
Back in on that takedown attempt is McCormack, able to secure the back and drags Wójcik down to the floor, gets that left hook in, and the right. Nicely done by Danni McCormack. And a ton of time to work here.
She's flattening her out, looking, right, inserting that arm right underneath. And she yanked her forehead up to get more space.
Karolina Wójcik has never been finished in her mixed martial arts career. That would make a statement tonight if McCormack is able to wrap this up via stoppage.
And that was just a beautiful adjustment by Danni McCormack here.
Might be under the chin here.
Looks like it's under.
Danni McCormack close to getting the tap. Flattening out Wójcik. It's it! She goes to sleep, Danni McCormack! Victorious tonight as she defends her Invicta FC Strawweight Championship. Unbelievable. Wójcik has never been stopped prior tonight. And not only does McCormack stop her, she puts her to sleep in Boston.
Speaks to the heart of the warrior in Wójcik, refusing to tap, just going out on her shield. But Danni McCormack, my goodness, what a champion.
She said she wanted to prove why she was a champion. Not just defend, but prove that she's as good as it gets here at Invicta at 115 pounds. And Megan, you couldn't have drawn that up any better for the Irish woman.
Well, it was such a beautiful adjustment when Danni went for that takedown. Instead of allowing Wójcik to use the cage to her advantage and stop that takedown, she pulled her off the cage and she was able to use that momentum to disrupt the balance of Wójcik so she could get that takedown. And what a moment.
Beautiful moment
for both of these athletes. The heart of both of these women is absolutely incredible.
What a moment, what a night. Danni McCormack victorious. She defends her title for the first time. She ties the record of some of the great champions to hold this title here at Invicta FC. The future is very bright for Dublin, Ireland's Danni McCormack.
And that is a proper fighter.
Well said. I don't know who to credit, you or Conor McGregor. We'll credit both of you. All right, to make this one official, for the time of the stoppage, we go to Joe Martinez.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes officially. 1 minute, 22 seconds, round number four. Technical submission by rear naked choke. For your winner, she is still the reigning, defending strawweight champion of the world, Danni McCormack.
What a night for Danni McCormack. Her belt wrapped around her waist once again. A proper fighter, a proper champion. She gets it done tonight in Boston. Victorious via rear naked choke, she'll speak with me.
Boston, give it up for Danni McCormack. Your first title defense. It's not a defense. You are proving again that you are a world champion, Ireland. You have an incredible athlete here. You're emotional. There's a lot going on. How are you feeling in this moment, Danni?
What do you think? I'm just so proud of myself. I've never performed like that ever before. And I'm saying to myself going out, there's no such thing as nerves. Skills pay the bills, and I'm so high level, and I need to show it, and I need to start believing in myself. And for some reason, this belt has like a superpower. It makes anyone that has any doubts for themselves just believe. So anybody out there that's finding this fight and crack hard, this is my 19th fight. I had like 9 amateur fights first. And this was one of the only fights I actually performed. So keep going. It does get easier, and look what you can get out of it. Do hard shit, because hard shit makes you a strong fucking person. And that's what I feel like, a superstar right now.
Yes, Danni!
Boston, you guys are amazing! Yeah. I felt like this was St. Paddy's Day in the middle of October, in the end of October. So thank you so much for coming to support me all the way from Ireland here to you. And Shannon Knapp, thank you so, so much. You did this for me. You didn't have to. And this is going to be one of the greatest nights of my life. And I'm forever grateful, Shannon. And thank you, Conor McGregor, and Forge Irish Stout, the creamiest stout around. And I'm sorry, Megan, I'm like totally hogging the microphone. But I have one more call out. Mick Maynard, you said you wanted to finish. So there you go, and that's the third one on my record, number 3. So let me know what you think about that one. Right, I think that, one more thing, shit, sorry. This guy here beside me worked with myself and my brother 7 years ago in Vancouver, and he's kept in touch with us since. His name is Scott, and he sold his car to pay for $2,500 worth of flights and accommodation to come here and support me. So come over here, Scott. This is the biggest fan around, that is for sure. You're an animal.
Thank you. Love you.
Thank you so much.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you're a Invicta strawweight champion. Someone get her a drink. Danni McCormack.
Again, strawweight, small in stature, big in star power and talent. And again, look no further than the reigning defending champion, Danni McCormack. Julie Kedzie, Emotional night for her, emotional night for us here in the booth.
Yeah, that girl always makes me cry. What's up with that? Stop it, Danni. What a brilliant performance by Danni McCormack. And just in the end, even in her post-fight speech, she's teaching, she's instructing. Granted, you know, with a little colloquialism, but I mean, that's fantastic. You know, this is, I don't know, TJ. These are the fights that make me want to push the table over and jump up and down and scream.
All right, well, at least we're not getting you back in the cage to fight, Julie. Megan, you've been in there. You won Invicta FC Gold. I mean, your thoughts on Danni McCormack's defense tonight?
I mean, it was exactly like Danni said. She performed tonight. You know, like we kind of mentioned earlier in the fight, is sometimes she needs to get dropped to wake up from a fight. And tonight, she, from the get-go, was just an improved athlete, an improved fighter. And it's just so inspiring to watch somebody who has had 19 fights now still learn, still grow, and still put on amazing performances. And I absolutely love it when the Irish get on the mic, because they're always going to say the most outlandish things.
Absolutely. Danni McCormack comes to Boston, paints the town green, and the gold is headed back to Dublin. What a night it has been for her, and what a night it has been for all of us here at Invicta Fighting Championships. Our first trip to Boston, it was one you could not afford to miss. We had action from start to end. Rhea Djukic victorious tonight over Fernanda Araujo. Then it was Brad Riley Martinez getting the win over Julia Dorny. Andrea Amaro, she followed it up with a submission of her own over Hilarie Rose. Co-main event, Kristina Williams, the warhorse, getting it done as she took out Dee Begley. Then Danni McCormack successfully proved why she's the champion in our main event. For Julie Kenzie, Megan Anderson, I'm TJ DeSantis saying so long from Boston. This has been Invicta FC 54.